and joining the choir in Detroit, This Is the Day on page 209.
Good morning, everyone. We have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love that you have for all the saints.
We have heard of this hope before in word and truth. God tells us to us.
We have not ceased praying for you and asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of God's will. Let us worship God.
Let us pray. Most holy God, you know our every thought and deed. Our lives are not hid from you. You dwell in the heights, yet you stoop to hear us. You inhabit the depths, yet you rise to support our efforts to serve you. You encompass the whole of creation and are yet concerned for our needs. All praise to you, eternal God. We honor and glorify your holy name. Amen.
Please join with me in the prayer of confession found in your bulletin. God of compassion, we confess before you that we have sinned. We have passed by your neighbors and ignored opportunities to show them mercy. We have mocked their misery by making excuses to avoid their plight. We who have been taught the law of love, practice and install the law of self-interest. Forgive us, we pray, for the sake of the Christ who came to bind up the wounds of the one by the side of the road. Here's Paul's words when he writes of God, who has transferred us from the dominion of darkness and to the care of Christ our Savior. So walk in Christ's love with assurance of your redemption and the forgiveness of sins. The peace of God be with you.
And also with you.
Greet one another in peace.
like to invite the children to come forward.
That's upstairs.
I'd like to invite the Martin children to come forward. Just come right to the middle, then they can all see you. Where's your sister? Oh, okay. Oh, here comes, all right, Bailey, all right. What, is she taking the long route? Oh, here she comes. Morning, Miss Olivia. I got this out of one of the classrooms downstairs, and I was wondering, obviously you know what this is, right? It's a clock. It's a clock. What is a clock good for? What is it good for? Telling time. This one's not working. Lee, you'll need new batteries for your clock. This one's not working real well, but if it had batteries that worked, it would be telling us what time it is. And how many hours are there in a day? How many? 24 hours in a day. How many hours do you sleep? 8, 10, something like that. So that leaves you 15 hours in a day to do stuff, right? What kind of stuff do you do while you're awake? What do you do? Wait for time to watch TV. Oh, she wants to go back to sleep. Bailey. What else do you guys do? What do you do during the day when you're awake? Do you play outside? What do you do? Go to school during school year? And I saw school supplies at Walmart this morning. What do you do when you're... That's right, you go horseback riding sometimes. What about you? What else do you do during the day? Go to the Dollar Tree. Well, there you go, you go shopping. Guys go grocery shopping. You do all kinds of stuff during the day. Well, in today's Bible lesson that Pastor Mark's going to be talking to your folks about, Mary and Martha are sisters, and they have to spend their time doing things around the house. And Jesus comes to visit, and one of the sisters is busy cleaning the house and getting ready for Jesus to visit, and the other sister is sitting by Jesus' feet listening to him tell stories. And she gets kind of mad at her sister. Her sister who's busy gets kind of mad at her other sister for sitting there and just watching. What this Bible verse is about is, how do we spend our time each day? One of the sisters spent her time doing things and didn't take time to spend it with Jesus. And our days get really, really busy. We have horseback riding, we have school, we have chores at our homes, we have projects we want to take care of. But what God wants us to do and what Jesus wants us to do is to carve out some time in our day to spend with him. Because if we don't, our lives just become this cycle of busyness. So that's the challenge, to enjoy all the things that we do, but to remember to take time out of those hours that we're awake and spend them with Jesus in prayer and in thought and in worship. So I'd like to challenge you this week, so when you're busy or you're waiting for to watch TV or go horseback riding, spend a little bit of time with God. Let us pray. God, we thank you that you give us 24 hours in a day. We thank you even more that those moments come but one at a time. And we ask you to give us the guidance and the wisdom to remember to set aside some of those moments that we may share them with you. Amen. All right, I'd like to invite you to Sunday school.
Our Old Testament lesson today comes from Amos chapter 7, starting at verse 7. This is what he showed me. The Lord was standing beside a wall built with a plumb line, with a plumb line in his hand. And the Lord said to me, Amos, what do you see? And I said, a plumb line. Then the Lord said, see, I'm setting a plumb line in the midst of my people Israel. I will never again pass by them. The high places of Isaac shall be made desolate, and the sanctuaries of Israel shall be laid waste. And I will rise against the house of Jeroboam with the sword. Then Amaziah, the priest of Bethel, sent to King Jeroboam of Israel, saying, Amos has conspired against you in the very center of the house of Israel. The land is not able to bear all his words. For thus Amos has said, Jeroboam shall die by the sword, and Israel must go into exile away from his land. And Amaziah said to Amos, O seer, go flee to the land of Judah. Earn your bread there and prophesy there, but never again prophesy at Bethel. For it is the king's sanctuary and is the temple of the kingdom. Then Amos answered Amaziah, I am no prophet, nor a prophet's son, but I am a herdsman and a dresser of sycamore trees. And the Lord took me from following the flock, and the Lord said to me, go prophesy to my people Israel. Now therefore, hear the word of the Lord. You say, do not prophesy against Israel, and do not preach against the house of Jacob. Therefore, thus says the Lord, your wife shall become a prostitute in the city, and your sons and your daughters shall fall by the sword, and your land shall be parceled out by line. You yourself shall die in an unclean land, and Israel shall surely go into exile away from this land. Our gospel text today comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 10, starting at verse 38. Now as they went on their way, they entered a certain village where a woman named Martha welcomed him into her home. She had a sister named Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to what he was saying. But Martha was distracted by her many tasks, so she came to him and said, Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her then to help me. But the Lord answered her, Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. There is one thing that is needful. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken from her. Let us pray. Lord, we pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts may be acceptable in your sight. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen. My daughter and my wife have changed my TV viewing habits a little bit. The first time this happened was several years ago for a show called Project Runway. And I remember the first time I came into the living room and it was on. It's a show about fashion and fashion design. And when I saw what was on the TV, I thought, there's no way I am going to watch this show. But Hannah and Melissa were adamant that we needed to watch this show and it was a good show. So I sat down and started watching it. And over time, I found that it was a pretty interesting show. And after I watched a number of episodes with them, I don't know how many, I was starting to venture opinions about the designs that the designers were making, what they did right and what they had done wrong. The next TV show that they changed my viewing habits about is called Say Yes to the Dress. And if you don't know what that show is about, it's about high-end wedding boutiques where people go and spend thousands of dollars for wedding dresses. And again, the first time I came in, that was on, I thought, there is no way I'm going to watch a show like this. But again, Hannah and Melissa were adamant that this was a good show and we needed to watch this. So I sat down and started watching it, and it was pretty interesting, especially the dynamics between the people as they're choosing the dress. And after I watched a number of episodes of that show, I don't know how many, again, I started venturing opinions about the dresses and whether they looked good on the bride-to-be or not. That's the way it is in life. We can get comfortable with the subject, and we can start to believe that we're experts on the subject. Even if I deluded myself for a few minutes about my abilities as a fashion designer and a wedding dress picker-outer, whatever that is properly called, even if I had done that, just for a few moments, I was clearly out of my field. I surely should not be giving opinions on these subjects. I certainly know very little about them. We can do that in life. We can think that we know enough, not only about a subject, but to tell other people what they should do. We have that in both of our scripture texts today. The first one is our Old Testament lesson today. And Amos has come to the northern kingdom to give them the words of God. Now, the words are not pleasant words. They're not blessings. They're not promises that God is going to multiply them and protect them. In fact, they are dire warnings. God is warning them, if you don't stop doing certain things, surely you're going to go into exile. These are very harsh words. So how in the world did Israel get to this point? Well, this is the time of the divided kingdom, long after King Solomon died. And at the death of King Solomon, the kingdom was divided. Solomon kind of started the ball rolling down the hill. He started in his later life with his foreign wives. He had many foreign wives, some of them out of desire, some of them out of political alliances. And the first mistake he made is that he didn't insist that they worship God when they became his wives. And so he set up for them high places, so-called high places, in Israel where they could go and worship, because certainly they couldn't go into the temple and worship. That was his first mistake. Second mistake was building these places for them so that they could worship. And his third mistake was, as he spent time around them and at these places, he himself began to worship to these other gods. Now, God warned him by the prophets that this is something he should not be doing. And then eventually God told him that if it wasn't for the sake of his father David, God would rip the kingdom away from him. But for the sake of his father David, he wouldn't do it to him, but he'd do it to his son. That's exactly what happened. On the death of Solomon, the kingdom of Israel split into a northern kingdom and a southern kingdom. 10 tribes became the kingdom of the north. 2 tribes became the kingdom of the south, which had its base in Jerusalem. And that divided kingdom had gone on for about 140 years until our Old Testament lesson. As I said, King Solomon started the ball rolling down the hill. And as we all know, as the ball rolls further down the hill, it picks up speed usually. And that's exactly what happened. King Jeroboam, who was the king of the 10 tribes right after Solomon in the north, he became worried that if people went down to Judah and worshiped at the temple and went to the festivals and celebrated the Passover and the other festivals they were supposed to, that their hearts would turn towards Rehoboam, the son of Solomon, and they would take him as being leader and actually kill him. So he decided to set up his own national religion, and he did this by setting up places of worship in Dan and Bethel. And to do this, he made graven images. And he told the people of Israel, these are the gods who brought you up out of Egypt. And then he appointed priests to be the individuals who were those who led the people in worship. Now, these priests were not of the Levitical priesthood, and they were not trained in the law of Moses. They were just people that he picked for his national religion. So Solomon got the ball rolling down the hill, and then Jeroboam makes it go faster and faster by instituting this national religion. And this is the perfect opportunity for those who want to worship the gods of the nations round about to use this national religion to worship other gods. And so that's the situation that we find ourselves in our Old Testament lesson day. This national religion has been churning along for about 140 years where other gods than the Lord God have been worshiped. Now, God has sent Amos and other prophets to the people to tell them to return to God. Stop doing these things. Start following the law of Moses. But the people didn't want to hear that. And Amaziah, a priest in our Old Testament lesson, he was rebuking Amos. Why? Because his power structure is in this national religion. He doesn't want people to return to the worship of God. He doesn't want people to return to following the law of Moses, because then he'll be out of power and out of a job. And so he confronts Amos. He thinks he knows enough to tell Amos what Amos should be doing. Of course, that doesn't end well for him. He's told that not only will all these things happen, but because you've done this, Amaziah, you are going to go into exile, and very bad things are going to happen to your family. In our gospel text today, Jesus is spending some time in the home of Mary and Martha and Lazarus. Now, Jesus has arrived with his apostles, and of course, there's a lot of preparations that need to be made so that he can be fed, they can be fed, and they can be housed. There's a lot of work that needs to go into the hospitality to supporting them. So, of course, Martha is the one who's doing this. Now, we've talked a lot about the relationship between father and sons, because Jesus uses that in his parables, and the relation between the eldest son and the younger sons, because again, Jesus uses that in his parables. We don't usually talk about the relationships between the mothers and the daughters and the sisters. But in that day, most of the work was segregated. So the father would go off with the sons and do whatever work they were going to do, and then the mother and the daughters would be left to do their work. And of course, the mother then was in charge. And of course, the eldest daughter was in charge, just like the eldest son was in charge in the absence of the mother. Now clearly, Martha is the eldest sister. And she is left because the mother and father are gone, and Lazarus would be the head of the household, her brother, but this is not his purview. This is not his work. So she is left to be the one to make sure all the preparations take place so that Jesus and the apostles can be fed and they can be housed. Now, what starts to annoy her is that her sister Mary, her younger sister, who should be listening to her by all the societal norms of her day, should be waiting for her instructions and her orders about how to get ready for these guests. She's not doing any work at all as far as Martha's concerned. Instead, she's listening to Jesus. And so Martha finally comes to Jesus and she tells him, "Don't you care that my sister has left me alone to do all the work?" And she tells Jesus, "Tell her then to help me." She's expecting Jesus to then tell Mary, "Yeah, get up. You need to help your sister." But that's not what Jesus said, is it? Getting back to our Old Testament lesson today, as an adult Sunday school class, we have just finished going through Amos and Jonah and Joel. And there's a particular individual in the adult class, by his own admission, he marches to the beat of a different drummer. And he has said this on many occasions. And one of the questions he has asked throughout this study is, how do the people know to listen to the prophets? And as much as it killed me, I had to admit in the presence of other people that this was a really good question. It's a good question. How did the people know to listen to the prophets? Taking our Old Testament lesson, for example, this national religion has been churning along for about 140 years. And so the people are very familiar with that. They're also familiar with this religion about the Lord God that also is very ancient in their eyes. So how do they know who to listen to? How do they know which group of prophets to listen to? How do they know which priests to listen to? It is a very difficult question, and it makes us understand how the people could have struggled in that time not listening to the prophets, because there were always other voices, other prophets representing other gods who were telling them just the opposite. Instead of the fact that they needed to repent, the other prophets were telling them everything is wonderful. Instead of God telling the people through the prophets, "If you don't stop doing this, I'm going to have you go in exile," the other prophets were saying, "No, these gods are going to bless you because you're worshiping them and you're sacrificing them." And so how did the people know? It's actually a difficult question. And it's a question for us today, because there are always a lot of voices in our culture telling us what we should do. So how do we know which voices to listen to? Well, our gospel lesson has some very good answers for us. The first thing our gospel lesson reminds us is that we are always a work in progress. In our gospel lesson today, Martha knew a lot of things, and she had listened to a lot of Jesus' teachings, and she realized that he was the Son of God, that he was God. We see that in Scripture. So she knew a lot of things. Spiritually speaking, she was way ahead of the curve, and yet there was still so much she didn't know. The first lesson we need to be reminded of in our gospel text is how we're all a work in progress. It's not like graduating from high school, where if you've done all the work and graduate, you don't have to go back if you don't want to. It's not like college, where if you've done all the work and graduate, you don't have to go back if you don't want to. It's not like learning a skill or a trade, that if you master it, then you don't have to go back to relearning it if you don't want to. This is a situation where we're constantly in progress. We're always trying to get better as disciples of Christ. The second thing that our gospel lesson tells us is how important it is to listen to Jesus. What was the answer that Jesus gave Martha when she came to him upset that her sister was listening to him rather than going about all the preparations for making him and his apostles' stay a good stay? He said, "She has chosen the better part, and that will not be taken away from her. She's listening to me," Jesus is saying, "and that is the best thing she could be doing at that very moment." What this reminds us of in our gospel lesson is how important it is to listen to the voice of God in our lives, to listen to the voice of Jesus. So how do we do that? Well, in the Reformed faith, we believe that the Scriptures become the Word of God to us as the Holy Spirit works in them and through them and on us. In other words, what our gospel lesson is telling us is we need to get into the Word of God. We need to be studying Scripture. We need to be reading Scripture. And not just by rote, not just putting the time in, but opening ourselves up to the Holy Spirit to tell us, to talk to us, to help us understand it, to help us understand those areas we need more work in, to help us understand those areas of strength we have that we can even be stronger in, to help us understand how to avoid pitfalls in life. One of the important things our gospel lesson surely tells us is how we need to be in the Word of God, and not just in it, but open to the Spirit leading us, so that the Word of God, the Word of Jesus, can indeed come to us, just as it did to Mary so long ago. Our confirmants this morning are wonderful examples for us. They have learned a lot in their confirmation classes. They have learned a lot in school, and yet none of us would look at them and say, "They're done." Well, that's exactly how we are. No matter how much we've learned from life, no matter how much we've learned spiritually, we're still not done. And it's important for each of us to be listening to the Word of God. And one of the important ways that happens is to get into Scripture. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you so much for your words, and we pray that by your Spirit you will help us to understand them. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. Benjamin Daniel Leotor, Ryan Thomas Sanderson have been received by session into the community membership of the church. They have studied God's word and have learned the belief and the practice of his people. They are to declare their faith and to be joined in the service of Jesus Christ.
Hear the words of our Lord Jesus Christ. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit. Everyone who acknowledges me before men, I will also acknowledge them before my Father who is in heaven. Friends, Jesus Christ has chosen you and in baptism has joined you to himself. He has called you together with us in the church, which is his body. Now he has brought you to this time and place so you may confess his name and go out and serve him as a faithful disciple. Ben and Ryan, who is your Lord and Savior? Do you trust in him? If so, answer, I do. Do you intend to be his disciple, to obey his word, and to show his love? Will you be a faithful member of his church, giving yourself in every way, and will you seek the fellowship of the church wherever you may be? If so, answer, we will. Ben and Ryan, you are a disciple of Jesus Christ. He has commanded you, live in his love and serve him, and be filled with gratitude. Let the message of Christ dwell among you in all its richness. Whatever you are doing, whether you speak or act, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Let us pray. Please join me in the congregational prayer in your bulletin. O God, our Father, we praise you for calling us to be a servant people and for gathering us into the body of Christ. We thank you for choosing to add to our number brothers and sisters in faith. Together may we live in your spirit and so love one another that we have the mind of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom we give honor and please be seated. We do have the joy today of celebrating the sacrament of Holy Communion, and so let us prepare our hearts and minds to receive this sacrament. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself, And when we had fallen to sin, become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and ending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive the holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace, and that the last day bring us with all your saints in the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And now let us pray the prayer our Lord and Savior taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. On the night our Lord was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it. And he said, This is my body broken for you. As often as you eat this, do so in remembrance of me. In like manner, he took the cup and he said, This cup is the new covenant in my blood. As often as you drink this, do so in remembrance of me. And as often as we eat from this bread and drink from this cup, we do proclaim our Lord's death until he comes. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that he died for you and feed on him in your heart by faith. Go ahead. the body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. Let us pray. Eternal God, our Heavenly Father, you've graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and fed us with spiritual fruit in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Are there any announcements that anyone has at this time? We have one announcement of joy, and that is you probably see two new faces in our choir, David and Maureen Parker. Thank you for joining us. We're so glad you're here. Any other announcements? Nope. Any prayer requests? Yes. Whose family?
Kenneth.
Yes. Okay, anyone else? Anyone else? Let us gather together as God's people in prayer. Let us pray. Lord God, we are thankful to have a Sunday where we have two individuals who have professed their faith in you. We pray, Lord God, we thank you for the blessing that they are in the world. We thank you for the gifts that you've given them. And we thank you, Lord God, for the part in your plan that you have allotted to each of them. We pray, Lord God, that you will always fill them with your spirit and your love and your forgiveness, and that they may know that wherever they go and whatever they're doing, that you're with them. We thank you, Lord God, for this wonderful day, and we pray that you will move your spirit in us to help us remember the promises that you've given to each one of us, how you have called each one of us, how you've gifted each one of us, how each one of us has a part to play in your wondrous plan. We pray, Lord God, that by your spirit you will help us to be good disciples and to listen to your voice. We also pray this day, Lord God, for those who we're concerned about. We pray for Kenneth and others. Let us take a few moments to pray for those we're concerned about. Lord God, we thank you for hearing our prayers for others. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Please join our prayer of dedication found in the bulletin. God of grace and truth, you fill us with the knowledge of your will, that we may gain spiritual wisdom and understanding. We seek to lead a life worthy of your calling in Christ. We bring you the fruit born of your graciousness with the prayers that it may be fitting your blessings and glory. Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and to be gracious unto you. May he lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, now and forevermore. Amen.